students. Today, I am here to discuss one of the primary and important topic from geography. So, it is something called as the continental drift theory. But before we go into this theory, I would like to explain or put forward some questions to you. The first question is, have you ever wondered, like, the land or a piece of land you are standing on, is it static or is it moving? Because we have heard so many times the earth rotates, earth revolves, but we never felt it, right? Similarly, now the question is, if earth rotates and if earth revolves, then is there anything that is happening inside the earth also? The first question. And second thing, if that is the case, if the land which we are standing on is moving or not moving, whatever it is, the next question arises is, looking at this world map today, had the distribution of land mass and the water mass been same in the past, or what was the past of this distribution? That is the second question. Now, when we think about this, also when we keenly observe into the distribution of land mass, there are few areas which actually seems to fit in each other. Like in childhood, we must have played a game which is basically about the jigsaw fit, right? The puzzle set, where we get different sizes and different shapes of cardboard pieces which we fit along to make an overall wholesome image, right? So the same way, if you look into today's world map, there is something that you will understand. There are few places which actually fit among each other. Why is it so? So when you think on these lines, there are several questions that arises in our mind, and what is the answer for it? Or the next question I would ask, are we the first people to think about these questions, or has someone already thought about this, and have they given some answer to this, or is it proved? The next set of questions that comes in our mind. So for all these questions, we will have a brief discussion today, where at the end of the discussion, you will be satisfied, hopefully, with respect to the questions that is arriving in your mind. So, starting with it, let us look into this beautiful world map that we have today. So, as I told you, if you observe, just one example let us take, so that you would be curious to understand or know more about this lecture. See, look at the coast of Brazil or South America, the eastern coast. When you look into the eastern coast of Brazil or South America, you also find that this part can actually appropriately fit in to the western coast of Africa. Why is it so? Right? So now I have given you only the sample. Let's go further and try to understand what is there in it. Okay? Now, there was this guy, Alfred Wegener. This person, he was a scholar in climatology, and he was also a scholar with respect to polar studies. Out of his curiosity, when he had the same question about the distribution of land masses and the water masses, he came up with a theory. But what made him come up with the theory? His thought process and the evidences he found out. So what are these evidences and what was his thought process all about? Before we dwell into that topic, the main important thing that he put forward, the present day landmass distribution or the ocean distribution is not static and has not been static. It is very dynamic part, and so now is the answer for the question I asked you at the beginning. The piece of land which we are standing on is not static. And even today, even now, at this point of time, it is moving. It is moving almost 10 centimeters a year on an average. Each plate or each landmass, let us not use a word plate today as of now, But each part of the landmass is moving at 10 centimeters a year. That will be somewhere equal to the rate of growth of human nails per year. Okay, so yeah, but if that is moving, so what is the resultant consequences or resulting actions or distribution that has happened? So before understanding, according to Alfred Wegener, he says the Earth's landmass distribution was not as you see today. It was a unified all landmass, and he termed it as Pangaea. Though it is called as Pangaea today, it was actually a Greek word which he gave, panga. Means here, if you split this word, pan matlab all, gea matlab landmass. So it's a all landmass, one full landmass. Here, if you look into this particular landmass, you can actually see all the continents of today's Earth were in the same place together. And this landmass was surrounded by one full ocean mass, which was called as Panthalassa. Again, pan all thalassa, water mass. So this was the name he gave to that historic landmass and historic water mass. Now, but what happened to this old landmass? Why did it break? Or did it actually break to form today's landmass or today's distribution? Or what happened? Did the ocean split this landmass, or the landmass split itself? Or what are the other reasons? If reasons are there, then how did Alfred Wegener prove those reasons? What evidences did he have to prove those reasons? All these things we will look in the course of the lecture. Now, before I start with what Alfred Wegener explained, let me ask you this. If somebody comes to you and questions you, what is your age? You would be in a position to tell that I am 20 years old. I am 25 years old. Something based on your date of birth. So let us take a small example. There is a person X. He is born on 1st January 2000. Okay. Now the question is, if I ask him what is his age, he would come up telling that his age is somewhere around 20 years, 10 months, and say 29 days. Okay. All these years, he was not the same person, physically at least. Physically, he has grown up from an infant to an at least adolescence age, right? So, the same way, now when we look into, Earth's age, it is believed that Earth was formed somewhere around 4.5 billion years ago. So, was the Earth same since then, or has it undergone some changes? And if it has undergone some changes, we need some reference line. Can we keep telling it is this many years, this many million years, this many thousands of years? No, it becomes difficult to refer in that terms always. So, what we have done is, the geographers have come up with a geological time scale. And this is a broad view of a geological time scale. geological time scale is basically divided into Precambrians. Okay, initially let me tell you how it is divided, then we'll go to the names. Geological time scale broadly classified into two super eons, the first one being Precambrian and the second one is not named. Okay, so we are not much bothered about the Precambrian super eon because whatever we study is from the super eon, that is the second one. In the first super eon, basically the super eons are classified into eons. It has three eons: Hadean eon, Archean eon, Proterozoic eon. Further, these eons, since I told you we are not much bothered into this Precambrian super eon, we will directly dwell into the second part. This unnamed super eon has an eon which is called Phanerozoic eon. This Phanerozoic eon is further divided into eras, and those eras are divided into periods, and periods will be further developed into epochs. So this Phanerozoic eon has three eras: Paleozoic era, Mesozoic era, and Cenozoic era. So when we look into this era, each of this era, as I already mentioned, is divided into further periods: Cambrian, Ordovician, Silurian, Devonian, Carboniferous, Permian comes under Paleozoic. Triassic, Jurassic, Cretaceous comes under Mesozoic. Paleogene, Neogene, and Quaternary belongs to the Cenozoic. Now you might be having a question: why is he naming all these things without even telling on what basis it is divided? Each of this period will be divided based on the significant activities or significant changes that had happened on the surface of the earth. Starting with, let me tell you, see, one or two examples I'll tell you, since it is not completely important, you just have to remember those periods which specifically I'll be mentioning. See, when you look into this particular Ordovician or Silurian, Devonian, Carboniferous, all these things, let us take this Carboniferous. Why is it named Carboniferous? Carboniferous is the period when the formation of coal, carbon, coal started. And the coal that we have today, almost majority of the high quality coal was formed during this Carboniferous period. That's why it is named Carboniferous. And if you take Devonian, Devonian is the period when amphibians came to life on the earth. And similarly, the Jurassic, Triassic, where dinosaurs were there. Okay, so like this, today which we are actually on the earth belongs to the Quaternary period. Today which we are on the earth belongs to the Quaternary period, and this Quaternary period is further divided into epochs, and we are in an epoch that is called Anthropocene epoch. Anthropocene epoch was recently decided epoch, which means anthropo means anthropo means human. Human influence is there in this particular epoch. That's why it is named after the human. Okay, so this part, though it is not very important, I wanted to explain this broadly so that you will have an understanding when I am speaking about the continental drift theory, which was proposed by Alfred Wegener. Moving further, this is what a broad explanation that was given by Alfred Wegener. Alfred Wegener said, if you remember this previous slide, this one, Pangaea, look at the shape of this Pangaea. He started with the same thing here. He says, during the period till Permian, during the period till Permian, the entire Pangaea remained intact. It was not split or broken or drifted. But what happened later in the Mesozoic era? For him, let me mark it with a different color, so we'll come back to this. For him, this Mesozoic era found the trigger to break the Pangaea into several parts or several pieces. Now, look at this. This is the Pangaea and the Panthalassa. If you keenly observe into this, you find today's Eurasia, Europe plus Asia. And North America is here, Africa is here. Do you remember the first slide when I told you the eastern coast of South America and the western coast of Africa fits into each other? So, can you see it here? Right? So, now the question which I asked you is again replicated. And also, you can see India here. The western coast is close to Africa. Madagascar. This is Madagascar. This is Australia. The southern coast, present-day southern coast or southern part of Australia was a part of the eastern coast of Antarctica. So, this was an whole landmass which was called as Pangaea. But over time, as I told you already, over time, it saw a small split and they drifted. Which direction did they drift? And what made them drift? Okay, before that, you must also be thinking, why did it split? Right? What were the factors that made this huge landmass to break? Okay, so these questions, few were answered, few were unanswered by Alfred Wegener. But these are the questions that brought a discipline into the study that is called as tectonics. So now, let me tell you what is tectonics. Tectonics is considered as a scientific study. Why? Because tectonics studies about two important things. One is the processes and the other one is forces. Of what? See, if you look into the land variations on the surface of the earth, have you ever wondered why is not our earth like a tabletop, flat throughout the world? Why there is fluctuations or undulations on the surface of the earth? Why do we have Mount Everest? Why do we have a Deccan Plateau? Why do we have a coastal plain? We are taking in a micro scale where we are considering India so that you will understand it better. Then, why is oceans always sort of on the coastal side? If you see, the oceans are, the water level is lesser than the land level. That is where we consider it as sea level. Or else, we always have heard, at least, that Mariana Trench is the deepest point on earth. Why is Mariana Trench being the deepest point? Why not the entire earth is on the same height or same level? All these questions were answered by tectonics. Tectonics is the scientific study where you will understand why exactly the earth's landforms or undulations are present in those places. Exactly why Himalayas is there at the border between the India and Eurasia, or for that matter, why exactly Mariana Trench is there near the Pacific Ocean. All these questions were answered by the study of tectonics because it speaks about the processes and the forces. These two things we will study more with the course of the lecture. For now, this much if you understand, that is good. So now, as I already mentioned, this part of the Pangaea, which happened to see a split. If you remember, go back to the previous slide, I told you till Permian, it was intact and static. Okay? But what happened? The Mesozoic era was the time when it saw a break or it saw a split, right? So, in that split, there comes the division of Pangaea into two large landmasses. Okay, good. But this split was filled by the water mass from the Panthalassa. This led to the formation of a sea, which is slightly lesser than today's Indian Ocean. Okay, this sea was called as the Tethys Sea. Tethys Sea. Okay, yes, Tethys Sea was between two large landmasses, and Alfred Wegener named these landmasses, the northern part, as Laurasia, or it is also called as Laurentia, and the southern part was called as Gondwana land. Now the question comes, yes, the split happened. Where did it happen? Today's continents, which of these continents are in which of these two landmasses? Eurasia and North America was part of the Laurentia, whereas the rest other continents, South America, Africa, Madagascar, India, Antarctica, and Australia, these landmasses were in the Gondwana land. Okay, fine. And then he said, with the passing time, when we enter today's phase or today's quaternary period, or let us take it as today's phase, the landmass on the surface of the earth is distributed like as we see in today's world map. Right? So, this was the basic theory that was propounded by the scholar Alfred Wegener. Now, I had put forward so many questions in your mind. And one thing I'll ask you, human mind is very curious and also very suspicious. We always think, what is happening behind the screen? Or what is happening with what is making this particular thing? So the same way when we thought, we have come up with this. But I told you the second part, human mind is also suspicious. Have you ever thought, did you ever believe anything without an evidence? Anything a human chooses or anything he believes is dependent based on the evidence he gets. So now, before we go to the evidence, Alfred Wegener, what evidences did he give and why should I believe him? Before that, I want to explain the continental drift little more in detail with respect to the time periods or the geological time scale which I had already mentioned to you. Yes. Now, do you remember this Permian period? This was somewhere around 225 million years ago. I'll write it as YA. YA means million years ago. Let me write it as MYA from now on. Okay. So, this Permian period, which belongs to Paleozoic era, right? Paleozoic era, this particular Permian period actually has seen the landmass as Pangaea. This we already spoke about. Then comes the Mesozoic era, which I happen to mention to you as the era which was the time period when the Pangaea started to break. This was broken, Tethys Sea was formed, and the northern mass was called Laurasia, the southern mass was called Gondwana. I have already told you what are the continents in these distributions. This happened somewhere around 200 million years ago. Okay, good. Next is the Jurassic period. Jurassic period is also the part of the Mesozoic era. Okay. In the Mesozoic era, during the Jurassic period, the Laurasia saw a split. This is North America. This is Eurasia. The Gondwana land also saw a split. This is South America. This is Africa. This is Madagascar, India, Australia and Antarctica. They just saw the split. They did not drift away far. They just saw the split. That's it. Then, further, in the Cretaceous period, Cretaceous period also belongs to Mesozoic era. This was somewhere around 65 million years ago from present date, where the continents started drifting apart. Now the question comes, why did they drift? And in which direction did they drift? What made them drift in that particular direction? Right? We have three questions. Why? Which direction? And why particularly that direction? These are the three questions we have, right? Let us answer this over the course of time in this lecture, okay? So, when they started drifting further, as I've already told you, if you remember, the piece of land which we are standing on today is still moving or drifting, right? So, based on that only, even today, from the 65 million years ago, it started drifting and it formed the present day map or present day distribution. Is this clear? So, moving further, now, why did the continents drift? I told you, immediately after discussing that part in detail, I'll be explaining you the evidences which was given by Alfred Wegener. We have to know the evidences, right? So, now the next topic which I want to discuss, as I've already mentioned, those are two different forces which was proposed by Alfred Wegener. The first one being equatorward, and the second one being the westward. The drift of the continents happened either towards the equator or towards the west. Why exactly only these two directions? That should come in your mind. Why not east? Why not south? Right? So, basically for this to explain, let me take each one of it at a time. So, let us first start with the equatorward movement. Yes. Have you heard of this force in physics called the centrifugal force? There are two forces which you would have studied in physics. One is centrifugal, the other being centripetal. So, centrifugal force is something basically when it is in a circular motion, it tends to move away from the center. When it is in a circular motion, the object that is in the circular motion tends to move away from the center. This is centrifugal. Similarly, when an object in the circular motion tends to move towards the center, this is centripetal. Now, you might have not understood clearly from the words I have told you, but I'll show you a video. Look into this. Can you see here, the water that is placed in the vessel, when it is rotated, right, in a circular motion, it is trying to move away from the center. Can you see the parabolic shape that has formed here? See, this is the center. From here, it has tried to move away. So, this parabolic shape, this phenomena, now equate it with the earth. Earth, which is geoid in shape, it is rotating from west to east, right? When it is rotating from west to east, what is happening is the Pangaea, in that Pangaea, the Gondwana land which was here, actually split into several continents or several land masses. These land masses when the earth is rotating, undergoes the phenomenon of the centrifugal force. When it undergoes the phenomenon of centrifugal force, look at the video. Same way, assume this water particles to be, the water to be the landmass, which when rotated is trying to move away from the center in a parabolic way. So, those continents which were here started to move towards the equator. This equator word movement was because of two other forces. Those two other forces are nothing but, one is gravity, the other being buoyancy force. Now, you might be having a question, how is gravity and the buoyancy force influencing? But before that, I want to put across a term which was used by Alfred Wegener for this particular centrifugal force drift of the continents. He called it as polar fleeing force, because the landmass moved away from the poles. Okay, so along with this, the buoyancy and the gravity of the earth were other two specific reasons that resulted in equatorward movement. Buoyancy is very simple. Now, you must have seen the videos which basically shows the launch of the new ships, right? These new ships, generally the ships are manufactured on the coast and then they are launched onto the water. So, when the ship is basically launched onto the water, the ship doesn't sink. It tends to fall on the water, but again it rises up. The force that is moving this ship upward is nothing but the buoyancy force. You can also try doing it. Fill a bucket of water and then put something, any object like a cork or a empty water bottle or something like this. When you put it onto the water, it just goes inside and again comes back to float on the surface. So, the force, the up thrust that is given by the water on a partially or fully immersed object is known as the buoyancy force. So, that force, how do I equate with Alfred Wegener's theory? So, here when we speak about this buoyancy force was the reason where Alfred Wegener said the continents or the landmass which are floating on the ocean crust. He said the land crust or the continental crust is floating over the oceanic crust. That is because of buoyancy. Okay. So, next. The next movement that we will be discussing is eastward movement. If you take the example which I had quoted earlier, go to this slide. Here, the North America and the South America, which were close to Eurasia and Africa, drifted towards west. Let me use a different color. Drifted towards the west. Here again, further drift. This further drift gave rise to the formation of Atlantic Ocean. Right? And why did it drift west? Alfred Wegener says the formation of tides. We are not speaking about waves. We are speaking about tides. We will discuss more about tides when we go to oceanography. But the formation of tides. See, how is the tides formed? Tides are basically formed because of the combined gravitational force or effect of Earth, Moon and the Sun. When the combined gravitational force of all these three celestial bodies act on the water surface, there is uprise or downfall of the water. That particular phenomenon is called the tide. And Alfred Wegener says, the tides that are formed, see, suppose Earth is moving in this direction, west to east, right? And the tides are formed at the eastern mass is moving towards the west. Okay, when it is moving towards the west, this tides, those are formed on the eastern mass, is pushing the continents towards the west. Okay, so this is what Alfred Wegener said as the reason behind the westward drift of the continents. I hope you have understood so far, why did the continents drift? I have answered this question, both equatorward and also the west, east, westward. Okay, yes. Now, the next question is, why should I believe Wegener? He said, equatorward and the westward is the movement that happened. Okay, fine. But what evidences did he give? Why should I believe him? Now comes the evidences part, which is very important part of his theory. Few people accepted his evidences and few people did not accept. And it is always believed criticism or the idea of finding faults is the mother of invention, right? So, now let us see what are the evidences and what were the criticisms, and based on the criticisms, where did this study of tectonics move further? Or who were the people who did not accept Alfred Wegener, and what did they do? What did they come up with? Did they give the answer at least? So let us look into these questions. But before that, let us learn what are exactly the evidences Alfred Wegener gave. As I have already mentioned, the jigsaw fit puzzle, the same thing. See, this is jigsaw fit puzzle. Generally, even we get this things as a game we would have played, right? We get some parts like this, where we tend to fix them to make the wholesome meaning of the image, right? Alfred Wegener played the same thing here. He says this part of South America, the Brazilian coast, fits appropriately and accurately on the eastern coast of the Africa. And the Greenland fits in the Baffin Bay, near the Baffin Islands, Canada. Okay. And this Eurasian part can easily fix with the North American part. And Madagascar, which is here, can fit in here. And this part of the western coast of India can fit in here, like this. And this part of Antarctica can accommodate the southern part of Australia. Right? Now get back to the image. Right? See? This is South America. This is Africa, Madagascar, India, Antarctica, and Australia. This is what I explained. North America, Eurasia. Okay, so the same thing here it is mentioned. Right, so this is the first evidence. He said the coastlines of the present day landmasses can be easily accommodating the other coastlines of other landmasses. That is what he said. Okay, this is the first evidence. This looks fair enough for something like the puzzle or the jigsaw fit theory. Okay, next, what is the second evidence he came up with? The second evidence that he comes up with is the formation of mountains. When the mountains are formed in a particular period, there the rock composition or the material that is making the mountains would be of same age, would be of same material, same quality, right? He says the Appalachian Mountains on the eastern coast of North America and the mountains in the British Isles, and the Caledonian Mountains on the Scandinavian country's coast. All of these form a continuous chain. All of these form a continuous chain, and they were formed during the same age time and somewhere around 500 million years ago. All the material or the composition of these rocks stays the same. Now, that's a good point, he said, and when observed, it was true. The composition was same. The age of the rocks was same. So, this is what he propounded. This is the North American continent, this is the South American continent, Africa, Eurasia of the Pangaea part, and this is the Greenland. Do you remember I told you the Brazil coast, Africa, the North American coast and the Eurasian coast, the Greenland coast and the Baffin Bay? See, you can see how the jigsaw fit puzzle set which he proposed is reflecting here. And when this particular mountain chain was formed, it was during the same time period that formed, and that is why it is like this. This is the British Isles, and this is the Appalachian Mountains, this is the Caledonian Mountains. Okay, so now it is sort of strengthening his proposal about the continental rift. Right? Let us look forward before we conclude anything. The next thing. Here, in this particular image, I am trying to explain what Alfred Wegener proposed as his evidence. There are the rock materials or the fossil evidences which he collected from several parts of the world. And he said, and he showed the similarities. Starting with, let us start with Lystrosaurus. This is a land reptile which used to live during the Triassic period. So, during the Triassic period, that is Mesozoic era, this land reptile used to live. Reptiles do not have the capability to swim thousands of kilometers, right? So, now Alfred Wegener says the fossil evidences of Lystrosaurus were found in the continuous landmass of Pangaea, which makes today's Africa, India, Antarctica. Each of this is separated by thousands of kilometers of ocean water mass today. Right? With this much of differences, how can this particular Lystrosaurus swim so far and live there? Then he says, this is one of the evidence that this particular Lystrosaurus reptile was found in a joined mass of Pangaea, which had these Gondwana land, which had these places, and also the Madagascar. Okay, so now, okay, with one particular fossil evidence, nobody would actually accept his evidence, right? So then he also took forward the next fossil evidence, which is called as Cynognathus. Cynognathus is a land reptile again during the same Triassic period. Okay, this Cynognathus is somewhere around 3 meters long. It is a reptile again. So, but this reptile was found in the South America and the African continent. So, when you look into these two places, it is approximately around 4,800 to 5,000 kilometers distance between the coasts of these two continents. Would this land reptile be able or capable to travel so much over the, swim so much over the oceans? So, the next thing he says is this fossil of the reptile Mesosaurus. This Mesosaurus is a freshwater reptile. What is freshwater? Freshwater is nothing but where the salt content is comparatively less. These freshwaters are found on the surface of the land, continental crust. For example, the rivers that flows, the lakes that we have, the ponds that we have, all these sources have fresh water. The salt content is less. Whereas the ocean water is higher in the salt content. That's why it is called marine water. So, those people who consume fish, they will be understanding it more better. The fishes that are caught from the coast are called marine fishes. The fishes that are reared in the ponds or that are fished from the rivers are called freshwater fishes. And even the taste would differ, and also the salt content. Because of the salt content, the particular animals or the particular living beings that are found in the marine water cannot sustain on the freshwater, and the freshwater ones cannot sustain in the marine water. So if you have understood this point, then this particular freshwater fossil, freshwater animal, freshwater reptile that was found in South America and Africa, how could it be found in these two places? Can it swim this much of distance? No. And these were the evidences that he put forward with respect to the fossil evidences. And one more thing, these are the evidences of the mobile living beings. Now, I'll discuss one more point which he has said about the immobile living being plant. This plant, Glossopteris, was found in the sedimentary rock structures of the Carboniferous period. If you remember, I told you the Carboniferous period. Carboniferous period was the period when the coal formations happened, right? Those sedimentary rocks had the evidences of this particular plant, Glossopteris. This Glossopteris was found in Australia, Antarctica, India, Madagascar, Africa, and South America. All the land masses of Gondwana had the evidences of this Glossopteris plant. Now, he has strengthened his point with these evidences, fossil as well as the plant evidences. So now the question which was put forward here, the fossil evidences, how can it be useful to prove the continental drift, was explained by Alfred Wegener saying, if these particular fossil evidences were found across these continents only, not in the North America or in the Eurasia, then it shows these part were together, right? So this is what he mentioned. Further moving, look at this particular image. But before that, look at this image. No, who doesn't like gold? Gold is one of the precious metal, right? Now the question is, there is a country here on the coast of Guinea. That country is named as Ghana. An African country, Ghana, has placer deposits of gold. What is this placer deposit? What exactly is placer deposit, and why are we speaking about placer deposits? Before that, understand this process. There is a mountain or a place where we have the reserves of gold. Now, it is not that the entire mountain is rich in gold. We go just excavate one stone and we get gold. It's not that way. The place where we get, we say it is a gold reserve, but it does have several other minerals. Okay. So what happens here is, along with gold, there will be several other minerals. But the question here is, when they find gold, there will be certain places which are called as veins, Along these veins, the concentration of gold will be little higher. So these veins are the ones which are extracted or exploited by human for the extraction of the mineral resources. Okay. So these gold veins, when exposed to weathering, it can be either because of the physical weathering, chemical weathering, or biological weathering, or whatever. Okay. Whatever the weathering agent be, when it is exposed to weathering, the sediments from these veins are carried away by the weathering agents, and it gets deposited somewhere else from the place of origin, away from the place of origin. This deposition is called as placer deposits. These placer deposits of gold was found in the Ghana coast, but it did not have the source region. When the curiosity raised, geographers or the geologist found out the source being in Brazil. It was in Brazil. The source is in Brazil. Alfred Wegener said, the source of the gold that has its placer deposits in the Ghana coast, the source lies in the Brazil. So, he says, these two continents were together like this, as shown in this figure. That's why these, when were weathered, left its placer deposits in the Ghana coast. Okay, and just imagine, what would be the weathering agent there? We have Amazon River, right? Amazon River could be the agent of weathering. So simple, right? So now, this was another evidence that he added to his valuable theory. Next one. This image looks little complicated, right? But I'll make it very simple for you. This part you see in all the continents, right? Here you see everywhere in these continents. These are nothing but tillet deposits. Little complicated word. I'll explain it for you. Tillet deposits are nothing but the sedimentary rocks that are formed because of the glacial erosion or glacial activity. When, imagine now, let us take this one. This is a glacier and this is the landmass. When it is moving, does it slide over like the skates we use? No. It just has a rough contact. The friction erodes the surface when it is moving like this, right? When it is eroding the surface, the small fragments that is being carried away by this glacier, at another point, it just accumulates when the glacier capacity to carry it further is exhausted. When it accumulates, it will be layers and layers. It will be like layers and layers. And this gets compacted to form the sedimentary rock. This sedimentary rock is nothing but tillet deposit. So, these sedimentary rocks were found in several areas across the world. Now, the question is, southern India, glacial rock. North India, I accept. Today, we have Himalayas, glaciers are possible, right? But southern India, Deccan Plateau, where today we see lot of farmers suiciding without water, attempting suicide without water. But if you find such glacier rocks there, isn't it a big astonishing fact? Yes, the same sort of astonishing facts were put forward by Alfred Wegener. He says it was found in South America, it was found in Africa. Africa, yes, it is again astonishing. Today it is in the torrid zone, equator and tropical, right? India, Australia, even this is in the torrid zone, and Antarctica also. Then he says, these land masses were together. When they were together in the southern part as Gondwana land, they were exposed to the glacier, and those glaciers were the reason behind the formation of tillet deposits. Clear? Yes. Now, you must be having a question. Whatever the evidences he has put forward were so convincing. Yes. Now, then you must be thinking, is the continental drift still happening? According to Alfred Wegener, yes, the continents are drifting. But there is one more thing I told you. for anything and everything, there is a group of people called critics. What did the critics speak about? Let us look into it one by one. First one. All these particular evidences and the theory which was propounded by Alfred Wegener was seen to be more based on assumptions. These were based on assumptions. How can you tell the coastline of South America was adjacent to the coastline of Africa? Coastlines are always very dynamic. They are prone to be changed with the time. How can you believe it to be like that? Right? And these were more generalistic also. Right? So, this was the first critic. Second one. When you remember, if you remember, the point that I put forward with respect to buoyancy force, I said, I always across, I mean, throughout the entire lecture, I had mostly spoken about that point where I told you the continents happen to float over the ocean because of the buoyancy force. So, does that mean Alfred Wegener said oceans are passive? Yes. Alfred Wegener said oceans are passive. This is one of the grave mistakes Alfred Wegener did. He said the oceans are passive, but the later scholars from the critics, the later scholars picked up this point to prove him wrong. Okay, and the third one. Fossil evidences. If you remember, I told you a plant, Glossopteris, which were found in the Carboniferous sedimentary rocks. Yes, though he proposed it was present in the Gondwana landmass, but later several other people discovered that the Glossopteris remains were found even in Iran, Afghanistan and Siberia. All these three countries were part of Laurasia. Then where is the explanation for that? That was another critic. The fourth critic, which was very important, he said the equatorward and the westward drift were the reasons for the continents to move. Now, he also said the gravity, buoyancy force, let me write it, gravity, buoyancy force, centrifugal force, tidal force. These forces were the reason behind this equatorward and westward drift. Now tell me, do you think a tide can push the continent? Or the centrifugal force can push a continent? Or any of this buoyancy or gravity can push a continent? Not really. They do not have that much capability to push the continents. So, this was another grave mistake. Okay. One more criticism. If you remember, initially I said, till the Permian period of the Paleozoic, right, Paleozoic era, the entire Pangaea remained intact. Okay, then in Mesozoic era, the split started to happen. And people started asking him, why was it intact till Paleozoic, end of Paleozoic? What happened during Mesozoic? What was the reason for its split? He did not have an answer. So that is where the another strong criticism fell on his theory. So like this, these are the important criticisms that happened to put a checkpoint on his theory. But never to underestimate, he had been one of the prominent scholar in the school of tectonics. Though his theory is not validated today, is not accepted today, but still his contributions as a person who sowed the seeds to understand the movements in the earth, on the surface of the earth, was very significant. It is unscientific what he propounded, but his idea was very well accomplished. So, to summarize the entire lecture, there was a person, Alfred Wegener. Alfred Wegener propounded his theory of continental drift theory, continental drift. He said, when he was asked, when he thought, what was the earth or the land masses earlier like? He said, there was one big landmass which was called Pangaea, and this was surrounded by Panthalassa, which was a one single ocean. And later on, it further happened to split during the, it started to split during the Mesozoic era. And with the split, what happened? It formed two large landmasses, the Laurasia, which comprises of today's North America and the Eurasia, the Gondwana land, which comprises of the rest other landmasses, South America, Antarctica, Australia, India, Madagascar, Africa. Okay. And it formed a scene between Tethys Sea. That Tethys Sea remnant is today's Mediterranean Sea. Okay. And as the equatorward force and the westward force acted upon these continents after the split, the continents started to drift, like North America and South America moved away from Africa and Eurasia towards the west. And the land masses of India, Madagascar, Australia, these places, and even Africa started moving towards the equator. Okay. And he said the forces behind were very simple: buoyancy, gravity, centrifugal force, and the tidal force for the westward movement. Okay. Now, with to prove his forces behind this drift, he propounded several other evidences. One was Jixophet. The second one was the mountains that was formed on the either coast of North America and the Eurasia. And the another thing which he also propounded was the age of rocks that was found on the Brazil coast and the African coast were 2000 million years ago, which were formed during the same time. And again, he went further with the evidences of fossils and the vegetation. And then he went for placer deposits and the tillet deposits. And finally, like this, he gave several other evidences. From these evidences arose the group of people who criticized his theory. And those criticisms were, the first one, they said assumptions. All his theory was based on assumptions and it was more generalistic. And the second one saying that, which Alfred Wegener proposed it to be passive, the oceans to be passive, but based on this point, this I did not explain much because this point will be the basis for explaining the next set of lectures, seafloor spreading theory and plate tectonics. So we'll take it up there. This is a strong point, strong criticism. And then came the fossil evidences, which were actually criticized by these people. And they said the evidences were found in elsewhere places also. And the equator movement and westward drift, where the forces being these were not sufficient to drift the continents. And finally, why Mesozoic era, which the person Alfred Wegener could not answer. So this is all about the continental drift theory. Let us look into the next set of topics in the upcoming lectures. Thank you.